Welcome to the Don Smith Show, where it's okay to be a conservative. And now here's your host, Don Smith.
Hey, thank you, Brad Smith, for that great introduction. And thanks to each and every one of you for tuning in today for another Don Smith Show, where it's always okay to be a conservative. We've got a great lineup for you here on the program. Of course, the last program of the year. We'll be back the day after New Year's, next Saturday on the 2nd. But today on the program, we're going to replay interviews with Donald Trump, Gretchen Carlson, and Judge Andrew Napolitano. These were all 2015 interviews. Actually, the first two, Donald Trump and Gretchen Carlson, were here within the last month to 5 weeks, I guess. So the big thing here, it's been a crazy year. It's been another crazy year. But things are getting to a point where we need somebody strong in here to turn this thing around. And I think that's one of the reasons somebody like a Donald Trump is resonating with the American people, also a Ted Cruz, people that seem to have the courage to try to turn things around. But as I look back at 2015, there's three things that really stand out to me, and I'm sure to you as well. Society, the breakdown in our society. I mean, we had an Olympic decathlon champion, Bruce Jenner, become the glamour woman of the year. Folks, it doesn't get any crazier than that. We're installing transgendered bathrooms in grade schools and allowing children of grade school age to determine which restroom to use. And this seems perfectly normal to people. I had an article earlier this year that I did on Sons of Liberty Media. It's called The Normalization of Deviant Behavior. And this is what we're doing here. Because if you have a problem with a boy using a girl's bathroom, you have the problem. If you have a problem with Muslims blowing people up and chopping heads off, you have a problem. This is dangerous stuff. Very dangerous stuff. We've gotten articles this year from professors at Yale saying that pedophilia is really no big deal, and we really need to be more sensitive towards losers that prey on innocent children, right? Because we don't want to offend them. They've got feelings too. See, the normal person, like you and I, that have problems with everything, we realize that that's like not good behavior. That's a normal behavior. There's a problem here. And I'm not the one with the problem if I call somebody a pedophile, right? These are the worst of the worst. But we don't want to hurt their feelings. No, see, we've got to get past that. Because I don't care if I hurt their feelings. I'm not really too concerned about that. You know? But you look beyond that. You've got the decline in society. One of the biggest causes, in my view, is the media. Because the media jumps right on board this stuff. Again, Bruce Jenner, 2015 Glamour Woman of the Year. There's no articles that say one of these guys is insane. No. What they do is they write articles about how the conservatives talk about it, right? Because they're the bad people. This is a year where we've had the president and the top the only contender on the other side to be the next president who have said we're worse than ISIS. This is the GOP is worse than ISIS. Just think about that for a second. Really? We're worse than terrorists? See, because I really don't think we are. But the media perpetrates all this, right? They carry this out. They're no more than carrying water for Barack Obama and his administration. We see it every day. And now they're doing it for Hillary Clinton. They can't wait to do it for Hillary Clinton. I think we all know that. But the biggest thing, And I think you have to have the first two. You have to have a breakdown in society, and you have to have a media that's good with that, to get to the biggest issue we have in this country, and that is the Constitution. We have people out there saying that, oh, well, this is outdated, and we just need to completely redo the Constitution. Look at the attacks going on right now. Terrorist attack, what's it about? It's about the Second Amendment. It's about that evil NRA, because the NRA apparently is responsible for terrorism. Even though Bernie Sanders says it's climate change, I know, but... So you've got to have a complicit media, and you've got to have a complicit society to even have an honest conversation about the Constitution. First Amendment, all across college campuses. There's no adults left on these campuses, right? Free speech? We need safe spaces where nobody can say these things. Here's a group of things that can't be said in this zone, this imaginary zone. That's pretty scary stuff. And if you remember, this all started, right, on the University of Missouri campus at a journalism school. The journalists are demanding a safe space. This is over the line, folks. When journalists need a safe space. Remember those kids? You're not allowed to take my picture. These were journalism students at one of the finest journalism schools in the country. So if you think media is bad today, we ain't seen nothing yet. Wait till these little urchins get out there and start running the media. I mean, you think Chris Matthews is bad, which they are, Rachel Maddow, all these people. Wait till these kids get out there. Yeah, like I said, we ain't seen nothing yet. So we've got a breakdown in our society, a media that's complicit in it and promotes it, and they're chipping away at that Constitution. This was the president, the legal scholar, remember? He taught the Constitution. Yeah, he teaches on a daily basis that it's bad, that it needs to be changed. There's a big difference. When we think of a constitutional scholar, we think of somebody who really understands it, defends it, and says, hey, this is what it means. But that's not what it's about anymore. A constitutional scholar, it's almost to the point where any scholar is a propaganda minister. Because this is what it's become. And again, without the media and without society saying, hey, wait a minute, this is nuts. When those things don't happen, we get what we've got today. And we've got one more year to get through. And this is not going to be an easy year. This is going to be the year that challenges not only our mettle, not only our strength to stand for what we believe in, but the candidates, right? This is what we're going to really see, because it's all about messaging, and we still don't have that down. Look at it this way. Right now, leading the GOP polls is Donald Trump, the best at messaging. He is. And a lot of people say, well, he doesn't sound presidentially. Folks, come on. We've had Barack Obama for a long time now, right? Is he presidential? No, not at all. Not at all. Nobody talks about Barack Obama's tone. Because whenever the GOP is on the right side of any issue, it becomes about the tone. Well, I don't like the way he said that. Right? Just like we were talking about earlier, the pedophile thing. They're not bad people. Oh, you can't. Don't make them feel bad. Really? Really? So this will be a very interesting year, because we've got a president who knows it's his last year, who's got a ton of executive orders he just can't wait to throw down on the American people. He doesn't care if you agree with it or not. Over 70% of the American people disagree with the Iran nuclear deal. Look what happened. And did he come out and say, now I know most of you don't agree with me, but here's why I did. No. You have a problem if you don't agree with this nuclear deal. Again, over 70% of the American people, that's both sides of the aisle. Doesn't matter. You are wrong. His whole life, he went around, marriage is between a man and a woman. Then all of a sudden, boom, one day, nope, he's all for gay marriage. And if you're not, you've got a problem. Now, he never had a problem. His entire life, nobody ever said, geez, I think you're a homophobe. Nobody will ever or ever has called Barack Obama a homophobe. Nobody's ever called Hillary Clinton a homophobe. She had the same view, even stronger than Barack Obama's. Right? But if you simply, as a conservative, believe in traditional marriage, well, that's right. You're a homophobe, automatically. In fact, it really doesn't even matter anymore what your views are, just that you're on that side. So that means you have to be this, right? Because we're all just one person, aren't we? This is going to be a scary year. Hopefully, it ends out positive. Hopefully, our GOP party, the Republican Party, can find a way to... How can you not message this stuff? How can you not make these things seem incredibly unreasonable? The Iran nuclear deal. Look at that. We've got Iran now because of our political process that's in our Constitution accusing us of not living up to our end of the deal. They just did a missile strike here, a missile launch here a week and a half ago, but hey, which is specifically forbidden, and we were told by the president that not only would it not happen, but that if they stepped out of line just a little bit, we were going to be right in there. Are we in there? No. Are we going to be? No. We've got a terrorist regime, not Obama's. That's a different story. We've got a terrorist regime in Iran accusing us of not living because of our political process. We've got a Congress that wants to tighten the controls. Iran wants us to let anybody, hopefully everybody understands what the issue here is, because Iran wants every single Iranian citizen who wants to visit the United States to be able to do so without even a second look. Does that sound like a good idea? From a terrorist Muslim country. Now, I'm a bad guy for saying that. Oh, the terrorist Muslim country, because not all Muslims are bad, blah, blah, blah. We hear that. That's the cry. Every time there's a terrorist attack, not all Muslims are... And, oh, we got to look out for the Muslim community. Who could forget? One of the craziest situations of 2015 was Ahmed, the clockmaker. The kid brings a briefcase full of wires into school. And everybody's supposed to go, oh, that Ahmed, he's such a silly guy. No, that's a pretty serious thing. And he knew exactly what he's going to do. That's why he's suing for $15 million now. The whole thing was contrived from start to finish. But what was the message that came out of that? How did the media play that out? Did the media come out and say, geez, you know, I guess it's kind of reasonable, with the exception of, and I'll give him credit because I never do this, Bill Maher. Bill Maher was the only liberal, and he got excoriated for it. He was the only liberal who actually came out and said, you know, I don't know, maybe this isn't, you know, such a good thing. The kid brought a briefcase full of wires, purposely knowing that somebody was going to finally say something. And they did. And good thing they did. Put it in this perspective. Because we got the Ahmed situation, right? And so somebody saw something and somebody said something. What happened? There's a $15 million lawsuit. Yet everybody goes, well, why didn't somebody say something? Folks, this is a situation that liberals create. Everything about liberalism is no win. There is no win. Because you could never give them what they want because they don't even know what they want. But when you give them something, it doesn't change anything. It doesn't make you now a good person, and it never will. Ask John McCain after the 2008 election when he thought that the media was going to... He was the media darling on the right. Because why was John McCain so popular with the media in 2008? Because he slammed Republicans, right? He talked about those crazy people like you and I that, you know, like believe in fiscal responsibility and those kind of crazy concepts. But the media didn't love him. The media didn't love Mitt Romney. They destroyed him, both of them. They had no respect for John McCain. So this is the way it's going to be, folks. Again, look at the college campuses. Look at the one of the top journalism schools in the country, University of Missouri. journalism students looking for safe spaces. I got to be safe. Oh, I don't want to hear these things that might offend me. Here's how the Huffington Post. Here's an ad that came out. This is after the Ahmad situation. And again, this is where the media is the problem. Listen to this ad that they put out after the situation happened. Because who was the victim here? Was the victim, let's say it was a real bomb. The victim would have been like everybody in that school, right? No. The real victim is poor Ahmad. Here's how that went down.
We deal with a constant climate of fear and hatred just because we're Muslim or we look Muslim. But this kind of thing happens to us all the time. And it's not just Ahmed. We've all been there. Like the time my coworkers had to hide me in the back room because an angry customer threatened to confront me. Like the time when my teacher told me I wouldn't get hired anywhere because I wear hijab. Like the one time I had my hijab pulled off when I was standing in a cafeteria line. Like the time people doubted me when I said, yes, I am American. This is the kind of treatment that isn't supposed to happen in America. There are millions of brilliant children like Ahmed who get discouraged for good from pursuing their dreams, their talents, their passions. Here's how you can help. Ask me about what I'm wearing before making assumptions. Speak up when you see a Muslim that's being wrong, because hate and bigotry is toxic for everyone, not just Muslims. And that's why we should all stand with Ahmed. We should all stand with Ahmed.
We should all stand with a little punk kid who purposely brought a briefcase full of wires into school to freak everybody out. Now, you know what, honey? I ain't standing with Ahmed. Gotta take a quick commercial break. We'll be back with more right after this.
Wouldn't it be nice if there was an easier, less expensive option than a traditional lawyer? At LegalZoom, you get personalized services for your family and your business that's 100% guaranteed. So go to LegalZoom.com today for personalized, affordable legal protection.
Patriotic Warriors is an activist organization built to engage our community through information, training, outreach programs, and other resources. Our members work together to share knowledge and take coordinated action to make our elected officials hear our voice in unison. While others talk about preserving our constitutional republic, Patriotic Warriors takes action by utilizing cutting-edge technology and proven strategic initiatives necessary to restore the American dream and preserve it for future generations to come. If you're truly concerned about the future of the greatest nation in history, visit Patriotic Warriors today. No more waiting for someone else. The time is now. Go to patrioticwarriors.com and make a difference. Patrioticwarriors.com. That's patrioticwarriors.com.
Wouldn't it be nice if there was an easier, less expensive option than a traditional lawyer? At LegalZoom, you get personalized services for your family and your business that's 100% guaranteed. So go to LegalZoom.com today for personalized, affordable legal protection.
Hey, America. I am so excited. I found eVoiceAmerica.com. It's the political take action site we've all been waiting for. eVoiceAmerica.com makes it easy to email my opinions directly to all my elected officials and representatives in Washington at once. And I and all of you can know what we are telling Congress for the first time in history. eVoiceAmerica.com. All you need to do is register with your address and zip code, log on, and eVoiceAmerica will provide your personal list of elected reps every time you log on, and much more.
This is Victoria Jackson.
This is Paul Vallely, Major General, U.S. Army, retired.
This is C.L. Bryant.
Hi, this is Chuck Woolery. You're listening to The Don Smith Show, where it's okay to be a conservative.
Fight the good fight!
Hey, welcome back to the program. I hope you all had a great Christmas yesterday. We did here at the Don Smith Show, so I hope you did as well. It's a It was kind of nice to unplug here for a couple days, but it's even better to be back now with you, and glad to have you all here this day after Christmas. So hope you have a great 2016, and stay safe over the New Year's holiday. Again, we'll be back on January 2nd at noon Eastern time for a normal show. So to all you regular listeners, no, it's not a special show, which regular listeners know that means shorter. It means like I'm wimping out on the full thing. But we'll be back next week with a full show. Also want to mention, too, we've got Ted and Shemaine Nugent, who will be on the program here in the month of January. Also, Dinesh D'Souza. So already lining up some great interviews. And Dinesh has got a new project out. Looking forward to hearing about that. And looking forward to hearing how Shemaine Nugent, well, how did she tame the Motor City Madman? I think that'll be interesting as well. Three problems again. This is really what we're talking about here today as we look over 2015. I think the biggest things that impacted our society, impacted our political process, and impacted the media. I mean, you look at the society. Again, I mean, you can talk about the Bruce Jenner thing all day. Well, I can't, but sometimes I throw up my mouth a little bit, but that's another story. But, you know, folks, there's something wrong here. At the same time, here we've got an administration that talks about gun control. But they talk about it in the context of terrorism because it's so much worse than terrorism, right? You're much more likely to be killed by a gun here in America than to have terrorists. So don't worry about terrorists. Let's focus on guns is their message. It's not a new message. We've all heard it before. But they keep trying to perpetuate this myth that it's just about guns, right? It's just about the guns. We have a mental health issue in this country, a really bad one. And I'll throw this into number two, the media. Look at some of these people in the media. I mean, some of these people are bat-you-know-what crazy. That's our first guest here is going to be the interview that we did with Gretchen Carlson, who is not one of those people. But just flip on MSNBC. It doesn't even, at this point, it doesn't even matter what show you watch. You could watch any of them. Because they're all insane. It's like if you're not insane, you can't work there. Chris Matthews, last week, this is where the media is dangerous. The media is dangerous because they tell you that you can't talk this way. Again, pedophiles, you got to be nice to them. Don't want to hurt the pedophiles' feelings. Chris Matthews wants to make sure also that we don't hurt the feelings of jihadists.
This sense we have that... The Republicans now say it's okay to hate Muslims. I mean, no. When you hear carpet bombing, there's no way to hear that from Cruz without knowing a lot of regular people that just happen to live in those geographic areas will die because you're carpet bombing. You're not going after the bad guys. You're killing everybody that's there. And also animals. I mean, call them what they are, bad people. But what's this animal thing?
What's this animal thing? They're just bad people. They're misguided, right? No, they're flipping terrorists. They want to kill us, and there's nothing you could give them that makes them not want to kill us, except convert. We could all convert, right? But we're not going to do that because we're Americans, and that's not what we do, which is what makes us so incompatible with this religion of peace. We're incompatible because of our Constitution. So, yeah, this sounds like a great idea, doesn't it? Let's change the Constitution so we can become more compatible with radicalized Muslims. Sounds like a fantastic idea. Not really. Bad people? Bad people. This guy just called Ted Cruz the enemy of the state, but the worst thing he can muster up about terrorists is that they're bad people. Fantastic. But at least the GOP, you know, at least he can still lash out at the GOP. We've got a president who, when there's a terrorist attack, remember this?
On Easter, I do reflect on the fact that as a Christian, I am supposed to love. And I have to say that sometimes when I listen to less than loving expressions by Christians, I get concerned.
Yep. You hear all the people in the back? Yep. You're damn right. Yeah, it's those darn Christians. You're always to blame, no matter what. If somebody makes Bruce Jenner feel bad, it's your fault. When Muslims kill people, well, you know, I've heard some Christians say some bad things. Are they lopping people's heads off? Are they burning people alive in cages? I don't think so. I'm pretty sure they're not. I've never seen a Christian do that. But, you know, sometimes they say some mean things. This is insanity. This is insanity on steroids. 2015, another MSNBC host, Melissa Harris Perry.
If there's somebody who is a hard worker, when he goes to Washington, is Paul Ryan.
I want us to be super careful when we use the language hard worker, because, I mean, I actually keep an image of folks working in cotton fields on my office wall, because it is a reminder about what hard work looks like.
There you go. The only people that ever worked hard were cotton-picking slaves, right? Because that makes sense. The language is as big a part of this as anything. George Orwell, we're all familiar with it. This is it. This is the newspeak, folks. This is what it's turned out to be. Bruce Jenner's Glamour's 2015 Woman of the Year. Period. There's your new language. How's that working out for everybody? Isn't that great? What a great message, too, to send to future generations, isn't it? But hard worker? The real problem here is people like Melissa Harris Perry. She keeps an image that she looks at constantly every single day of slaves in the field picking cotton. Because, you know, Melissa, she was just released, I think, here like a week ago, wasn't she? This is the problem in this country right now. But between black Americans and white Americans, is it's perpetuated by this kind of stuff. If you sit and look at that picture, I'm sure you're going to have some pretty angry feelings. If your whole life revolves around slavery, yeah, that's going to be kind of tough. But the problem is, you've got people like Melissa Harris Perry, who has no connection to slavery. You know, how many generations do you have to go back, right? Blaming people who have white skin, who also have no connection to slavery. And I'm sorry, you're not going to get those people, I know I'm not going to accept responsibility for that. It's a horrible thing. I don't know anybody who thinks slavery should be come back or it was a great thing. I don't even know anybody who thinks, it wasn't really that big of a deal. No, everybody gets it. But you're perpetuating anger against people who had nothing to do with it by people who had nothing to do with it. Period. That's the problem we have today. Biggest missed opportunity. President Barack Obama was probably the only candidate who could have done something about it. Unfortunately, he did. He made it tenfold worse. We have never been more divided as a nation as we are today. And that's along racial lines, socioeconomic, political, pick a line. We have never been more divided. Last week at his State of the Union address, weekly address, the president actually said, there's nothing we can't accomplish when we stand united. Nobody's destroyed the fabric of our society more than President Barack Obama. Nobody has brought people against each other more than President Barack Obama. And he talks about unity? You know, it just doesn't jive. And we know that. We know that. But we, again, will always be the one with the problem. Not him. It will always be us. That's what we've got to fight back against. And that's the one thing, I'll go back to the Donald Trump thing. This is why he resonates, because he doesn't care. He says it. That's it. Here it is. It's not elegant. He doesn't soft pedal anything. He's in your face sometimes. Sometimes it's a little too much. But you know that's what he thinks. You know that's what he feels. You look at the thing with Chuck Todd here, right? The thing with Chuck Todd, where, well, words matter, and if you want to be president, it matters. And here's a guy who supports Hillary Clinton, who said she was named after Sir Edmund Hillary, which is a complete lie, a proven lie. And she says, it was just a cute story my mom used to tell. So your mom used to be a liar. So your mom was a liar, too, is what you're saying, right? Here's a woman who talked about Bosnia being under sniper fire. And the video shows her, a girl greeting her with a bouquet of flowers. Which is pretty close to sniper fire, but not quite. Here's a woman who's lied about she can't tell you what she had for breakfast without lying. She'd have to make something up just because it's not even in her DNA to be honest. Does Chuck Todd or anybody else in the media care about that? No, only Donald Trump. Because Donald wants to be president. Apparently Hillary doesn't. Or at least somebody hasn't told Chuck about that. Again, that's the role the media plays in this. I had an opportunity here right after Thanksgiving to sit down with Fox News' Gretchen Carlson. I think Gretchen is one of the better folks that are on TV. As far as journalism goes, I think she does a great job. Kind of missed her on Fox and Friends. I thought she always did a great job of keeping Brian and Steve Ducey in line. But had an opportunity to sit down and talk to her about her book, Getting Real. But we talked about more than that. We talked about some of these things. We talked about society, about this everyone gets a trophy society. We talked about faith leaving our society or being shoved out, right? Because we see that happening as well. But it was a great opportunity to sit down with her and go over her real message. And I think this is the really positive thing about the show here today is you can overcome obstacles. And that's the biggest problem we have. Again, whether you want to talk about race issues, whether you want to talk about socioeconomic issues, this is still America and you can succeed. You have very successful people today from different backgrounds, different ethnicities, telling others that there's no chance. As if somehow they were just able to magically step aside all these things that make it impossible to succeed. They were just so good that they made it. Now, you don't have a chance because you're not as good as them. But they made it. This was the missed opportunity of Barack Obama. This man could have stood up and told everybody, I'm the president of the United States. God bless America. But he didn't. He didn't. He was some anomaly that was just able to somehow slip through the cracks and accidentally succeed. And we know better than that. So, got to take a quick break, but right after that is my sit down with Gretchen Carlson.
In a time when military unemployment continues to skyrocket, All American Veterans Services is committed to reversing this trend and providing a solution to the problem. Nobody is more equipped to handle the pressures of running a business than the men and women who served in the United States military. By donating today, you can provide assistance to our nation's heroes. Your donation will create jobs, honor our veterans, and help build new American dreams. While there are many great nonprofit organizations out there, no charity makes a more profound impact in the lives of our veterans than All American Veteran Services. Creating new businesses, helping veterans find jobs, and providing the professional services required to re-enter civilian lives are just some of the ways that All American Veteran Services provide. Working with great partners like LegalZoom and Regis, veterans are not only provided with an opportunity to live the American dream, they are far more likely to be successful. With all that our veterans have done for this great country, there is no better time than today to help make a difference in their lives. So donate today and ensure that our nation's heroes that fought for our ability to live the American dream can start living their own dream. Please visit allamericanvets.com right now and help make a difference in the lives of those who've sacrificed so much. That's allamericanvets.com.
Been looking for an online gathering place? You know, a familiar screen, does everything you're used to, except give you grief for being a conservative? You gotta try the Tea Party community. At TPC, you'll know how everything works from the very first minute, and you'll probably find a lot of friends who are already there. Organize, communicate, share ideas, upcoming events, pictures, and videos. The Tea Party community connects and empowers like-minded, politically conservative people. Like you, sign up today at TeaPartyCommunity.com.
Look at you, casual online banker. And you, yeah, you, intense elevator texter. Expert photo sharer. And 380 friend follower. Can't forget you, online shopping pro. Hey, cool boots. All connecting to everyone and everything. But do you protect yourself? Apparently not. Thing is, you live in a digital world and you're not turning back now, and that's okay. Shop, post, browse, follow, bank, and stream. Knock yourself out. Because while you do your thing, we'll be here at LifeLock doing our thing, monitoring over a trillion data points, watching out for things your credit card alone can't, and relentlessly protecting your identity. Get LifeLock protection and live life free.
Let's
say you need to take care of legal matters. Wouldn't it be nice if there was an easier, less expensive option than using a traditional lawyer? Well, LegalZoom came up with a better way. We took the best of the old and combined it with modern technology. Together, you get quality services on your terms with total customer support. LegalZoom documents are accepted in all 50 states, and they're backed by a 100% satisfaction guarantee. So go to LegalZoom.com today and see for yourself. It's law that just makes sense.
Hi, this is former Congressman, Lieutenant Colonel retired Alan West.
Hi, this is Ben Shapiro, New York Times bestselling author of Bullies and editor-at-large of Breitbart News.
Hi, I'm Charlie Daniels, and I'm on the Don Smith Show, where it is okay. In fact, it's wonderful to be a conservative.
My pleasure right now to bring on, you know her, from Fox and Friends, you know her from The Real Story on Fox News, but she's got a great book called Getting Real, and it's Gretchen Carlson. Hey, Gretchen, welcome to the Don Smith Show.
Hey, Don, thanks so much for having me. Hope you're having a great day.
I am. I hope you had a great Thanksgiving.
I did. Happy belated Thanksgiving, and we had a house full of people from Minnesota, which is where I grew up. They came out to the East Coast, and they're heading home today, so we had a great time.
Well, there you go. We're actually up in the frozen tundra of Wisconsin, so kind of right next door. So I want to talk about this because we're talking on the program about, I think we had a missed opportunity with the president and with a lot of people right now in leadership positions where success is becoming somewhat demonized. And somehow if you did succeed, it's ill-gotten. And you have an amazing story. And I love this book. Getting Real is great because it actually tells you that it's okay to succeed and it's okay to overcome obstacles. Was that somewhat your inspiration of writing this book?
Completely. You know, I started this project about my life story about 10 years ago, and then I stopped it for various reasons, and I'm really glad that I didn't write it then because two big, huge things happened to me in the last 10 years. First of all, I was lucky enough to have two beautiful children, which completely changes your perspective on life, obviously. Mm-hmm. And makes you feel even more grateful. And then number two is I went to Fox News 10 years ago, and that really changed my career path just, you know, so dramatically. But the story really is about the American dream, and you're exactly right. That seems to be chastised by some at the moment that, you know, the stories of working hard and what so many immigrants decided to come to America to try and achieve and that you can do it here, you know, you can only do it in America in this special way. And that was my life story, growing up in a small town in Minnesota. And, you know, my mom used to put me to bed every night and say, you know you can be anything you want to be in this world. And God gave you gifts, and he expects you to make the most of them. And so I knew, you know, I believed her, but I knew it would come with a tremendous amount of hard work.
You know, and that is such a great message, and I don't know how many kids are getting that today, that you can be whatever you want to be. But let's talk about this, because you came from Miss America to Fox News. Now, I've heard a lot of people say, wow, that's really strange to go from that spectrum to go into media, but especially politics. Let me talk about this because there's a lot of politics in the Miss America contest, so you kind of had a little bit of a proving ground before you went into the news media world. Would you say that?
Yeah, that's an understatement of the century. You know, I had grown up a really serious concert violinist as a child, and that was really my career as a kid. And then when I turned 17, I burned out and told my parents I didn't want to play anymore. And that was very devastating to them because of the time and commitment I had put into it. So I promised them, they made me promise, that I would find another goal to achieve using my violin talent. And long, long, long story short was that my mom got a brochure in the mail about the Miss America pageant. She called me at Stanford, where I was studying at the time. She said, Gretchen, I found something for you to try because 50% of a contestant's points are based on talent, and you have that. And I said, are you nuts? I mean, I'd grown up a chubby kid. I talk about that a lot in my book, Getting Real, about how I struggled with my weight, and I still do. I just have learned how to manage it a little bit better. But, you know, really I was a novice in the pageant world, and I was from Minnesota, which is not known as a big pageant state. Nobody had ever won playing the classical violin, and if you haven't noticed, maybe you can't tell on TV, but I'm short. So all these things were working against me, but once I decided to give it a go, then it's sort of been the mantra of my life that I give 110% to everything that I try to achieve and never, ever give up. And those are great life lessons. You know, it happened to work out for me. I was very fortunate to become Miss America. And then, you know, getting into the television world was certainly not an easy path for me either, even though I had this great accomplishment in my life. I actually had to work triply hard because sometimes the stigma of being Miss America was not always a positive thing.
Yeah, absolutely. I was just going to say that because I think that's a big, if you look at the pageants today, and do you think that, like, talent, because for you, that was a big part of your campaign, if you will, because you have a great talent with the violin. Has that become lessened as we've gone on? Because to me, it seems like it is, and it seems like there's almost like a mocking thing, like we've got to make people look stupid if they're in this. Is that something you see, and does it concern you?
Well, I don't think that any of that has changed, unfortunately. First of all, I always like to point out that there's a huge difference between Miss America and Miss USA. There's not a talent category in Miss USA, and in Miss America, obviously, there is a talent category, and all the money that you win has to be used for education. It's scholarship money. So that really sets it apart from the other pageants, but it's, you know, it's hard when people see just pageants in general. They don't know those differences. I mean, I'm on the board now, so it's my life mission to try and make sure that people understand the difference. But what I say in the book is that when I got to Fox News, I reached the bimbo trifecta. I mean, I say that in a laughing way now, but, you know, I was a natural blonde, a former Miss America, and now I was a Fox News host, and it was like, wow, you must be really stupid. It's unbelievable how somehow in our society having blonde hair has become synonymous with being dumb. And I don't really know where that started, or attractive women just can't be smart. And, you know, so I think that the minute a pageant contestant makes an error, and by the way, I would challenge any one of us to get up on a stage and answer a question extemporaneously and see how you would do. But any time that they, you know, anyone makes a small mistake, it, like, goes viral and it's all over YouTube, and they're like, see, we told you so. Pageant contestants aren't smart. I actually had them do the average GPA of all the state contestants a couple of years ago because I wanted to just prove what I already knew. And the average GPA of 50 state contestants was 3.7. And you know, I just, that's certainly not the national average, obviously. It's
right.
Better than that. So, you know, I continue to work hard in what I do every day to prove those stereotypes wrong. And I always say that I work more for my son, who's 10, than I do for my daughter, who's 12, because I hope when he grows up and gets into the business world that he will respect his female colleagues the same way that he respects his mom right now. And a lot of the change that we're going to have to see in our society with stereotypes and such is not only women, but men changing their points of view as well.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I think that's one of the great things about your book is this is not just an inspirational story for women. This is something that men can learn from. You know, one of the things I learned early in life was if you want to be successful, you should find other successful people and try to mimic some of the things they're doing. Try to learn how they got to where they got to. And this is the great thing I think about your book is you really spell out the whole journey. And I think that's a great thing. Most people leave out the bad things, the negative things, or where they had setbacks. Tell us a little bit about why you included that into your book.
Yeah, you know, here's the thing. I've never met a successful person who didn't have a lot of failures along the way because that's just the way life works. It's about successful people are the ones who keep trying after they've had a downfall. And so, you know, I try and incorporate that into my lives of my children as well, especially in this entitlement nation that some children are being raised in now where everyone gets a trophy. I just don't agree with that. You know, we really need to teach our kids at a young age the idea of failing because that is what leads us to continue to work harder to gain success. So for me in writing my story, people have said, well, wow, the book was so candid. I can't believe you talked about that or this. And I said, look, I'm not going to write this book unless I tell you about things that have happened in my life that have made me stronger and made me persevere even more. So starting at a young age, being a fat kid, you know, being taunted and teased and having to learn how to overcome that and build my self-esteem from the inside of my soul, which is one of life's greatest lessons, not from your exterior. I struggled with a life-threatening stalker. I've never told this story until I speak about it in the book. Sexual harassment, I've never talked about that till I talked about it in the book. Being fired the week after I got married and being told that I'd be fine now that I had a husband.
Jeez.
Which was a little hard to take. I was already in my 30s, so it didn't feel so good. You know, struggling with infertility. That's a silent problem that so many couples go through. And the greatest joys of my life are my two children. And, you know, I never thought I'd be able to have them. Our first child was born with a tumor in her eye, and we faced major medical decisions with regard to her sight. And so, you know, I like to describe in the book that, especially with my TV career or becoming Miss America or practicing the violin, nothing ever really just came, you know, lickety-split easy for me. This mm-hmm. story is about persevering, never giving up, and always being dogged about achieving a goal.
And that's what's so great about this book, again, because I think it's so great. People think, you know, they look at Gretchen Carlson, and probably a lot of people think, wow, yeah, Miss America, now she's got her own show on Fox. Life was just easy breezy, no problems. And that's what I loved about it. Another thing I loved about the book, you have never shied away from talking about faith. And it seems like, and a lot of my listeners think that this is kind of being taken out of our society, out of the fabric of American culture. I applaud you for being brave and bold, because it almost takes that today to be so involved in your faith and to be not afraid to discuss that. Are you concerned about the direction our country is going when it comes to removal of faith from schools and from, you know, just from other areas of our culture and society?
Completely. You know, I wrote a column for FoxNews.com shortly after my book came out called "I Can't Believe It's Criminal to Be a Christian." Mm-hmm. And that's sort of the way that we find ourselves in 2015. Listen, I was so blessed to grow up in a wonderful community in Minnesota where my grandfather was the Lutheran minister in town. And so I grew up in a faith-filled family where I spent a lot of time at the church during the week. I taught Sunday school. I still do. My husband and I teach Sunday school now. And so, we, you know, we really, really, really believe that that's the greatest gift that we can give our children as the foundation in their life. So, yes, this is being stripped from our society. I don't really understand what is so wrong with saying that you are a person of faith. Is that intimidating to people, or is it because they don't want to have faith, so then they don't want to like you? Or it's kind of unbelievable to me, quite honestly, because I thought having faith in your life was a positive thing. And so I take a tremendous amount of flack being one of the very few national news anchors that continues to speak about my faith publicly and also on my show. And if I really read all the blogs that talk horribly about me every day because I do that, then I wouldn't get out of bed in the morning. So that's why I don't read them. And I really don't give a rip about what they say about me. You know, it's interesting. The number one thing that people say to me on the street is, thank you so much for talking about your faith and speaking about your values in your life. Mm-hmm. So I figure I'm doing something right, I think, even though I have detractors.
Well, I think you're doing a lot of things right. And then that was one of the biggest comments I got, too, was people appreciate the fact that you do that. So just so you know, my listeners are with you on that. Now, the number one question I get from my listeners, and I always take a question from the listeners, is they want to know, what has it been like for you to go from Fox and Friends, and specifically the fact that that's a pretty early start to your day. What's it been like for you to go from Fox and Friends, now to have your own show where maybe it gives you a little bit more normalcy, maybe not, I don't know. What's that transition been like for you?
Yeah, well, the first thing is I don't have to set three alarms for 3:45 a.m. you know, and I loved doing Fox and Friends. I did that show for 8 years with Brian and Steve, and it was a perfect thing to do when my kids were toddlers and even little people, because I would go to work for 3.5 hours before they were even up. And so they really never even missed me that much. When I got the opportunity from my boss to be able to do my own show, and not only that, professionally it was a great move, but personally to be able to be here in the morning with my kids and stay up a little later at night with them, it just was perfect timing. You know, my kids are 10 and 12. They really need me more at night for studying and just to be here in the morning for that quick, you know, homework thing or finish studying for a test. So it's been wonderful professionally and personally. I will tell you this, though, that even though I used to do 3 hours on Fox and Friends and I just do an hour now at one central time, I do have to tell you it's actually more work. Mm-hmm. Because when you're in charge of your own entity, you know, you can't really slack ever. And not that I slacked on Fox and Friends, but there were two other hosts, and if I had a late night or something, I'd say to them, hey, guys, you know, you guys do more of the talking today. And and now I really can't do that. So I think from just a professional point of view, it is a little bit more responsibility. But both have been amazing opportunities, and being at Fox has just been a great life changer for me, because speaking of faith, they don't frown upon people speaking about their faith and their values, and I think that that's just wonderful.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I guess I never realized that you kind of went from a team sport to be in the lead there. And that does make it definitely more challenging. And you can't just throw it over to Brian or Steve and go from there. The book is called The Real Story. Usually I give an angle why I recommend a book when I do recommend one. In this one, Gretchen, there's so many different angles to it that we touched on here, just a few of them. Highly recommend this book. You can get it at GretchenCarlson.com. Gretchen, you're doing a great job. My listeners love you. Thanks for being on the program today, and I'd love to have you back again in the future.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I loved speaking with you. Have a great day.
Okay, you do the same. That's Gretchen Carlson, everybody. The book is Getting Real, and you can get it at GretchenCarlson.com. All right. Fox News' Gretchen Carlson, and it's a great story. And this is the thing, because a lot of people think that, wow, that must have just been an easy ride. Everybody has challenges. It's how we choose to deal with them. You could, Gretchen, okay, she's an airhead. Read the comments today. Go on anything right now where they post a story where it's a clip from Gretchen's show, right? She's an airhead. She's anything but. She's a very intelligent woman. But because she was Miss America, she's got to be an airhead, right? No, that's not the way it is. But everybody has challenges. It's how you choose to use them and how you choose to overcome them. Or you can choose not to. You can choose to become a victim. You can say, well, I've got this going on, so therefore there's nothing I can do. We've talked about this a number of times, and I want to go in and talk about this a little bit more, because I think this is something that's really important. When you look at the way things are treated in our society today, look at some of the insanity that happened this year. We've already talked about the Bruce Jenner thing. This, to me, was the most insane thing of 2015. So we don't have a drum roll or anything like that. But listen to this and just remember back to when this was going on. Now, this is the come to Jesus moment, and I'm talking about Rachel Dolezal, right, who identifies as a black person. Seriously, identifies as a black person. Because now apparently in our society, this is an option. Skin color is now optional. We're born with what we're born with. I mean, it is what it is. I mean, every story today is about how mostly white men this, mostly white men that, mostly white women this. That's because most people are white. I don't know. People are getting sick and tired of having to apologize for their skin color because that's what it's become. But this was the most insane thing, and this was the only thing. This is the important part about the Rachel Dolezal story. This was the only thing to the left that went a little too far. Bruce Jenner, Glamour Woman of the Year. Rachel, this one really didn't play out. This is pretty sad when this was the only act of insanity of this year, and there were a lot of them. There were a lot of them. There's going to be a lot more next year and the following year. This was the only thing that went a little too far.
Let's be living honest. You don't answer the questions. It came across as you lying and saying you were a race that you weren't. Am I correct?
And I think, you know, a single headline can change.
So even now, sitting here asking you, we're saying, why not say you're white, but you identify as being black, and you don't seem to answer the question straight on.
My question to you, not identify how you identify. Like, why not give me the right to identify how I identify? I give everybody else the same, you know. And we are all entitled to be
correct.
Exactly who we are and to identify.
Rachel, I think it's kind of hard because you're not black. So when you identify with it, there's a disconnect. You know what I mean? Like, you weren't born black. So when you say you are black, it makes it hard for people to understand where you're coming from.
Right, and that's why I thought I acknowledge I was biologically born white to white parents.
This was the only thing to the left that crossed the line. It's the only thing. You didn't hear anybody yell out to Bruce Jenner, but you were born a man, right? This was the only thing that crossed the line to them out of everything that happened in 2015 or every position that the liberal came out with. That's crazy. That is bad. You know what? Crazy. But how does it happen? And this goes back to number two, the media. because the media is the one who allows this to happen. People read the headlines of these stories, and that's all they read, right? All conservatives are bad. It doesn't matter what your position is. That's really the bottom line here. I remember we had a clip here a couple months ago, and it was taken off of a Sopranos episode. Okay, granted, Hollywood's TV, it's made up. But how often do we see things on TV that mimic what's going on in society today? So you can't just blow off, because Hollywood has gotten fully active in this transformation of our society. You're not winning an award anymore. Unless you're making a movie about slavery or the rights of gay people, or you're not going to win anything, right? That's what it's got to be about now, because there is an agenda here. There's a very solid agenda here. Listen to this, because I think this kind of sums it up. This is the clip from The Sopranos. Here's how it works, right? And in this case, they're talking about education, but think about how many things have happened this year, but also over the last 4, 5, 6 years that fall into this category, because all you have to do is demonize it. Islamophobia, homophobia, all you got to do is demonize it. Make the other side with their views be crazy, right? Be rednecks, be whatever thing they want to throw at us. But I think this really sums it up, because this is how it works.
Dad, how come you didn't finish college?
I had that semester and a half at Seton Hall.
Yeah, and?
Grandma and Grandpa didn't stress college. They were working class people.
How come your parents were anti-education?
They weren't anti. Can't lay it all off on them.
See, that's how it goes down. If you don't support something, you have to be anti, right? You have to be anti. How come Grandma and Grandpa were anti-education? Nah, that's not what he said. They didn't promote college. It doesn't mean they're against it, right? For conservatives today, just because we think, oh, it's slightly disgusting to sell fetal parts, as we call them, baby parts, we think that's kind of bad. But if you think that's bad, well, then you don't care about women's health. You're anti-women's health. Huh? No, nobody's against women's health. And how is that a women's health issue? How is selling baby parts a women's health issue? If we can't, folks, if we can't message that one away, we are in bigger trouble than even I think we're in. If we can't message that away, the selling of baby parts somehow is a women's health issue. They've even come out and said things like, do you know how many lives have been saved? Do you? They don't know. They can't tell you that. You know, there's no statistics. Now they'll come up with them, and now that people are asking them. But they'll justify anything, because the ends always justifies the means, and that's what they're all about. And it applies to every single issue. I don't care who you are as a conservative. Carly Fiorina, right? Look at the debate stages. Look at the Democrats. You've got three old white people. Now, granted, you've got both kinds of old white people. You've got female and male. Look at the difference on the GOP stage. Now, they're the Big Tent Party, right? Wow, really doesn't look like it, does it? But they have no problem. They have no problem mocking Senators Rubio and Cruz for being, they're Hispanic. Imagine the GOP if they were running on the left, and the GOP called them, like Mika Brzezinski called Marco Rubio a boy. He's like a little boy. The outrage would be through the roof. But it's not, because it's okay for them to do it. Chuck Todd has a problem with Donald Trump because he wants to be president. Your words matter. Truthfulness matters. Bosnia, Sir Edmund Hillary, the server, Benghazi. It doesn't matter if you're Hillary Clinton. If you're Carly Fiorina, your face is demented. You're like a Halloween mask. Not a problem. Now, granted, that was on The View, and yeah, it is what it is. But it wasn't a problem. They even defended it. They even defended those comments and told her she better toughen up. Because that's how it works when Hillary Clinton complains about something, right? Everybody goes, hey, Hillary, suck it up, rub some dirt on it, babe. What are we doing? That's not how it goes down. They said she looked demented, like a Halloween mask. Not a problem. Now, granted, okay, a lot of crazy things are said on The View. We all know that. But that's this is the double standard that people are upset about, and rightfully so. Rightfully so. When we get into this election season and it's down to two candidates, Hillary and whoever we end up with, is Donald Trump or another candidate, the double standard is going to be off the chart this time. Because it's progressivism. We've progressed, right? It's progress. It's good. It's not, but that's what they tell us. I'm going to take a quick commercial break, but I want you to stick around, because right after that, we've got senior judicial analysis for Fox News, Judge Andrew Napolitano. I cheated a little on this one, because we looked through all the 2015 interviews that we did and picked the best three. Judge Andrew Napolitano was actually about a year ago right now. About a week before Christmas of last year. But it was so important, what we talked about, because it was about presidential power grabs. Why is that important? We've got a lame duck president in his last year, and he's got a whole list of things to throw down our throats. He just came out this week and said his last State of the Union address isn't really going to be about policy. It's just going to be about having a conversation with the American people. We all know what that means. That means President Barack Obama wagging his bony little finger in our face, telling us what horrible people we are. Because that's what a president really should do, isn't it? Not so much. We'll be right back.
Patriotic Warriors is a grassroots organization built to engage our community. While others talk about preserving our constitutional republic, Patriotic Warriors is taking action to restore the American dream. If you're truly concerned about the future of this great nation, visit patrioticwarriors.com today. The time is now. patrioticwarriors.com. That's patrioticwarriors.com. Have you ever been frustrated when you go to the doctor and are asked to fill out forms over and over again? And you're asked for information that you don't remember, or you have to submit the same form to multiple organizations. And each time you are asked to fill out the same form by hand. What about filling out business or legal forms, all manually? Maybe you've spent a lot of time filling out a form, made sure that everything is correct, and oops, the person who re-entered the data into the computer system made several mistakes. Why couldn't you do it from home in advance, where you can find all of the necessary documents? Now you can, at formateer.com. The next time you need a form filled out, the information can be found right at your fingertips. If you're an individual, you may find some forms ready to use on formateer.com, or we may be able to create a custom form for you at a very low cost or no cost at all. If you're a small business, formateer.com will be happy to create a set of forms or a complete data entry solution for your business needs. If you're a business that provides software, IT solutions, or both to another business, formateer.com has a great solution for you as well. Our parent company, RenderX, provides software and solutions to a very diversified group, from individuals to Fortune 500 companies. Even the United States government budget is formatted with RenderX software. With formateer.com, customers can fill out forms from their homes in advance when and where they have all the required information, or they can edit information that has changed if they filled out the form previously. No writing for them, no data reentry for you. Form filling solutions for businesses or individuals at formateer.com. That's formateer.com. The TeaPartyCommunity.com website was built to provide an online safe haven social community for all of the Tea Parties across America to utilize and enjoy. Tea Party Community serves as a hub for sharing ideas, unifying a movement, and organizing strategies to keep America in her rightful place as the greatest nation on earth. Visit TeaPartyCommunity.com today to open your free account. At TeaPartyCommunity.com, we welcome all factions of the Tea Party and conservative movements to join us here and establish their presence. Upgraded and special privileged accounts are available for large conservative groups and nonprofit organizations. Join TeaPartyCommunity.com today and get involved in the process of taking our country back.
My mother froze everything. I was 18 years old before I had my first fresh bun. The invention that I came up with is the Hot Dog Easy Bun Steamer. Steam is the key to a great hot dog. I knew it was going to be a success. The invention was so simple that I knew I needed to protect it. My name is Chris Chute, and I got my patent, trademark, and LLC on LegalZoom.
We created LegalZoom to help people start their business and launch their dreams. Go to LegalZoom today and make your business dream a reality. At LegalZoom.com, we put the law on your side.
I'm Deneen Borelli, author of Blacklash.
Hi, I'm Senator Mike Lee. Hi, this is Governor Scott Walker and the Don Smith Show, where it's okay to be a conservative.
You can lay down if you want to.
Hey, welcome back. Again, I hope you all had a great Christmas day and glad to have you all joining me here the day after. I appreciate that. You know, it's tough. Two of the people that I think are the most knowledgeable when it comes to the United States Constitution, and one of those I would say is Utah Senator Mike Lee, who we've had on, highly recommend his book, Our Lost Constitution. It's a great book, and it really gives a lot of a great perspective of how people have viewed the Constitution over the years, and these are scary times today. Again, people are saying, oh, this is outdated. We got to change this. We got to. Yeah, there's a little too much free speech. But there's a poll that came out on millennials that say over 40% thinks that the government should get involved in what's considered free speech and what isn't, which is the exact opposite of what our founding fathers built this country on. It's never to be up to the government to say this word's okay, this word isn't okay. Okay, you can say this, but you can't say this. Because I think we know how that would all play out. Conservative speech is what these people are looking for safe spaces from. They don't want to hear conservative points of view. Barack Obama recently came out and said, you probably heard this. A lot of people went, geez, what? Wow, that's kind of weird to hear the president say that. Saying that the left is sometimes intolerant of other views. He went on to say, if you listen to the whole message, what he went on to say was that sometimes the left doesn't engage those on the other side. Remember 2008, get in the face of your neighbor, right? That's what he means. He doesn't mean, oh, be more accepting of their ideas. No, no, no. He means get in their face, shut them down. Because that is the arrogance of liberalism. So we sat down with Judge Napolitano, and this was actually, I cheated a little bit because we looked through the 2015 interviews. This was one of the last live interviews we did in 2014. So this is actually almost exactly 1 year ago. We sat down with Judge Andrew Napolitano to talk about the Constitution. Fox News' senior judicial analyst, Judge Andrew Napolitano, presided over 150 cases while serving on the bench of the Superior Court in the great state of New Jersey. Judge Napolitano is also a New York Times best-selling author, and his latest book is entitled Suicide Pack. Judge, welcome to the show.
Oh, it's nice to be on with you, Don. Thanks very much for sharing your audience with me.
Well, you know, this week we saw the release of the CIA torture report from the Senate. What was the most shocking thing in the report from your perspective?
The acknowledgments by professional interrogators and members of the intelligence community, that's the CIA and others, that the torture that was inflicted on people that the government detained did not provide what's called actionable intelligence. That is, it did not provide them with information that they didn't already have or didn't already acquire from some other source.
You know,
I'm familiar with those arguments. That torture doesn't work, that the tortured person will say what he thinks the torturer wants to hear so as to stop the torture. That's a standard argument against torture.
Mm-hmm.
But the acknowledgments with proper names of people who participated in this stuff, that in fact it didn't work, is absolutely damning to the torture lobby and cuts the heart out of their strongest argument. The pro-torture groups, which is in the government and around the government, the pro-torture lobby's strongest argument is, hey, it kept us safe and none of these victims were American. Well, we now know that it didn't provide us with any information. It didn't keep us safe. It wasn't necessary. It was absolutely criminal. Of course, we also know that we have a president who won't prosecute anybody for it.
No, and that was kind of my next question. As a legal analyst, what do you think the repercussions of this report will be on the intelligence community going forward?
Nothing. The reason I think there'll be no repercussions is because the people who broke the law did so during the Bush administration. It would be up to the Obama administration to prosecute them. And the Obama administration has a strong incentive not to prosecute anybody from the Bush administration, so that the blank administration, fill in the blank, whoever's going to succeed Barack Obama as president, does not prosecute his people. There's an unwritten rule that except for the most obvious, most egregious, most public, most unpopular of criminal events, the Justice Department will not prosecute officials from the government of the administration that preceded it. And that's what you're seeing here. Oh, I take that back. The Obama Justice Department prosecuted one CIA agent for all of this torture. And they prosecuted him for revealing the torture.
Wow. Yeah.
That is a sad and sick sign of law enforcement in our country. His name was John Kiriakou. He's a CIA agent who was prosecuted and found guilty of revealing the existence of the torture. He's serving a five-year term in a federal penitentiary.
You know, there's a lot of this that goes back to, there's still this debate over the Patriot Act. And this is something that I think really baffles a lot of people, a lot of my listeners, and myself personally. We heard from many on the left that they didn't like the Patriot Act, and it was a knee-jerk reaction to 9/11. Yet when the president and some of these same liberals had an opportunity to change it, Judge, they really kind of seemed to strengthen it, in my opinion. What do you think about that?
I think that there's very little difference between the two parties when it comes to aggrandizing power for themselves and for their employees in the government. And I think as many people in the Democratic Party are in favor of the Patriot Act as are members of the Republican Party. The Patriot Act is the single most hateful, unconstitutional piece of legislation since the Alien and Sedition Acts of 1798. Because the Alien and Sedition Acts allowed the government to prosecute and punish people who were critical of it, even though the First Amendment says Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. The Fourth Amendment says if you want to search people's belongings, their houses, persons, papers, and effects, you have to go to a federal judge and get a search warrant. The Patriot Act allows federal agents to write their own search warrants in direct violation of the Fourth Amendment. The First Amendment, first, says Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. The Patriot Act permits the government to prosecute people for telling anyone that they received a federal agent written search warrant. So it violates two portions of the Constitution at the same time, the guarantee of freedom of speech and the guarantee that searches and seizures will only occur pursuant to warrants issued by federal judges. It's been invalidated by five different federal judges, but the Justice Department continues to use it. If a FBI agent shows up at your door with a self-written search warrant, one in which he has authorized himself or he has been authorized by another federal agent to search your documents, you better not accept the document. Once you do, you fall under the purview of this act. And if you tell anyone, your spouse at home, your priest in a confessional, your lawyer in her or his office, even a federal judge under oath in a public courtroom, you could be prosecuted for revealing the existence of one of these self-written, agent-written search warrants. It's reprehensible.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up the Alien and Seditions Act, because in your new book, you make the case that presidential power grabs, well, they're nothing new. And I think many may not know about the Alien and Seditions Act that was signed into law by President John Adams in 1798. Why was this a power grab?
Well, this was profoundly unconstitutional and bitterly ironic. Bitterly ironic because the same generation, in some cases the same human beings, who wrote, supported, and ratified the language of the First Amendment, Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech, in fact did make a law abridging the freedom of speech. The Alien and Sedition Act, most of which had to do with aliens coming into the country and the circumstances under which they could legally stay here, nevertheless made it a crime a crime punishable by 2 years in federal prison of uttering words which brought the president or the government or the Congress or the courts into disrepute. It's hard to imagine that people were actually prosecuted for this, but they were. The most famous prosecution was of Congressman Matthew Lyons, a congressman from Vermont who stood in front of the White House and mocked the president's waistline by calling him his rotundity. Congressman Lyons was prosecuted under the Alien and Sedition Act and was convicted and sentenced to 2 years in prison. While in prison, he did something that if you're from New Orleans, Chicago, Boston, or Hudson County, New Jersey, you're familiar with. He ran for re-election from his jail cell, and he won. So it has a happy ending. By the time he got out of jail, the obese John Adams who had put him there was no longer president. A very thin, handsome, red-haired Thomas Jefferson, who refused to enforce the Alien and Sedition Act, was living in the White House.
Jeez, insanity, Judge. You also point out that freedom and liberty are often sacrificed in the name of national security, which I think is a great point. With all the chaos around the world right now, do you see that as a forewarning to the loss of future liberties?
Well, one of the things that the both political parties, leadership, and most members of both political parties will agree on is that our rights come from the government. Now, the Declaration of Independence says our rights come from our humanity, which is a gift from God. And every president has articulated that view. Only Jefferson followed and really believed that view. But this is not an academic argument. If our rights come from our humanity, well, then they can't be taken away by majority vote. They can only be taken away if we surrender them. So a bank robber, when he steals the money in the bank, surrenders his right, his freedom of travel, because he's given up that freedom of travel by traveling into the bank and stealing the money. So he can be locked up in jail. But that doesn't permit the government to curtail the bank's right to loan money. However, when the Congress enacts statutes that restrict freedom, like the Patriot Act or the Alien and Sedition Acts, it is basically saying, we are the source of your rights. It's like a water spigot. We can turn it on and turn it off. Where this is going to go, I don't know. What bothers me is when people say the courts must balance liberty against security. That is profoundly wrong. Yep. It is not, the relationship between liberty and security is not one of balance, it's one of bias. Bias in favor of liberty. Every doubt, every insecurity, every question, every benefit, every presumption must be in favor of liberty because it is a natural aspect of our humanity. Security is a good that we buy and that many of us can acquire on our own. Liberty comes from our humanity. The government can't balance it against anything.
Great point, Judge. Now, Suicide Pact, latest book. Where can my listeners go to get the book and to stay up on top of your writings and the things that you're working on?
Well, you can stay on top of my work by visiting Judge Knapp, JUDGENAP.com, or by going to the Fox News Channel's website. There's always something that I'm doing up there. You can buy a Suicide Pact at Barnes & Noble or Amazon or any bookstore. In fact, this week and the weeks preceding Christmas, it's in all the bookstores and all of the major airports in the country. However, if you go to suicidepactbook.com, you'll not only get the book delivered to you within 2 days, but you can choose one of my other books, and it'll be sent to you for free.
So that's,
how's that for a Christmas time treat?
That's fantastic, Judge. So that's suicidepactbook.com. Judge, thank you for your time. Thanks for all you do. It was a pleasure to have you on the program today.
All the best, John. I hope we get to do it again.
All right, Judge Andrew Napolitano, everybody.
You know, this guy definitely understands the Constitution, and there are a lot of things that we need to be concerned about. One of the key things I think that came up in that interview was the Alien and Seditions Act, because this was the first time that our government tried to criminalize any whatsoever, any bad statements about the government. Folks, that's what Sharia law is. Okay, this is the big argument that's going on right now, because Sharia law says you can't. It's against the law, punishable by death, to say something bad about the Prophet Muhammad. We've got a government right now. We have Democrats who want to hold oil companies criminally liable for denying man-made global warming. Something that they can say the debate's over. They can say they've proven it. They've proven nothing. So now they want to criminalize the leaders of these oil companies. And again, millennials, over 40% think the government should be able to do these kind of things. That's not what America is. If that's what America, if that's what the future generations wants us to become, and this is what they're being taught in school, but that's not what America is. There's articles ever since this came out, right, about the oil companies, and you got to hold them accountable, and we should be able to criminally prosecute these oil companies. Think about that. What law is being broken by the oil companies? And if those laws are being broken by the oil companies, aren't they being broken by every single citizen who uses or benefits from fossil fuels? How can you separate that? You show me a Democrat that wants to prosecute one of these people that lives in a cave, uses no electricity, doesn't fart. Okay, then let's talk. They don't exist. They're like unicorns. But they want to criminally prosecute. And ever since that has been floated, it's a trial balloon. It'll be just a few years before they're able to actually do that. These kind of articles are coming out on a regular basis now. Here's one off of The Guardian, which is just a fantastic site. Just 90 companies cause 2/3 of man-made global warming emissions. Well, there you go. Chevron, Exxon, and BP, among companies most responsible for climate change since the dawn of the industrial age. Figures show the industrial age is what contributed to America's greatness. And now we want to hold people criminally liable for the industrial age. Think about that. If that doesn't scare the bejesus out of you, I don't know what will. The climate crisis of the 21st century has been caused largely by just 90 companies, which between them produce nearly 2/3 of the greenhouse gas emissions generated since the dawning of the industrial age. The companies range from investor-owned firms, household names such as Chevron, Exxon, and BP, to state-owned and government-run firms. The analysis, which was welcomed by the former Vice President Al Gore, imagine that he welcomed that, that's amazing, as a crucial step forward, found that the vast majority of the firms were in the business of producing oil, gas, or coal. Found the analysis, which has been published in the Journal of Climatic Change. Ooh, I got to pick that up. There are thousands of oil, gas, and coal producers in the world. Climate researcher and author Richard Heed at the Climate Accountability Institute, because doesn't that sound great? The Climate Accountability Institute. But the decision makers, the CEOs, or the ministers of coal and oil, if you narrow it down to just one person, they could all fit on a Greyhound bus or two. You see where we're going here? Yeah, because Richard Heed wants to round them up, put them on a couple buses, and haul them off to prison. Half of the estimated emissions were produced just in the past 25 years, well past the date when governments and corporations became aware that rising greenhouse gas emissions from the burning of coal and oil were causing dangerous climate change. Really? That's been proven, huh? Isn't this amazing? Assumptions. Right? Assumptions, they're facts. Nope, they're facts. They held the producer of the video in Benghazi criminally responsible. No more free speech. Free speech is way overrated, according to liberals. They put that person in jail. They want to do the same thing here with the oil executives, because you can narrow it down to one person per company. Because only 90 companies are responsible. Do you remember? Okay, I remember back being a kid, right? The ozone layer. Remember? There was going to be no more ozone layer anymore because everybody was using spray-on deodorants, right? Anything that sprayed. So, big mass thing. Get rid of all the spray cans. Do you hear anybody talk about the ozone layer anymore? I don't hear that anymore. But it was going to be gone. Al Gore, the genius. Al Gore said that there weren't going to be any, there's not going to be more ice. Several reports told us there wasn't going to be any more snow in winter. Now, okay, granted, we're sitting here, it's pretty warm down here today and pretty warm yesterday across most of the country. Guess what? It's winter. It's going to get cold. And there will be snow. But they tell us there's not going to be snow. You listen to people talk anymore. I remember climbing out of the upstairs windows to get out of the house. Come on. I grew up in Wisconsin. Did we ever have big snowstorms? Of course we did. You know what? They still do. But we're told it's not. And if you listen to anybody talk, holy cow. We used to get 30 feet of snow every day. No, we didn't. But this is what's being taught in the schools. Again, we talk about the journalism, the safe space people from University of Missouri. Those are the future MSNBC people. Those are the future whatever other loon channel they're going to go to. Just imagine what media is going to be when these kids take over, when Chris Matthews is long gone, and you got this next generation they've been taught this their whole lives. Imagine the tax that will go against oil companies. I want one liberal, one of them, to tell me what law is being broken by drilling for oil, by mining coal, by drilling for natural gas. Name one law that's actually being broken. Now, of course, the answer is there aren't any. Still want to criminalize it. And this is a president that talks about our tone? These people want to put people in jail. No problem with that tone, though. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing to see here, folks. These people aren't doing anything wrong. And we're all using the oil. Put it into this perspective. They want to criminalize the oil companies because they're trying to portray fossil fuel as some kind of a illicit drug or something, right? That's the context they're putting it in. At the same time, these same people are legalizing drugs. These same people are releasing criminals from prisons. Oh, they shouldn't be in jail. But they're talking about gun rights. They're talking about gun control. That's the important thing. These people want to criminalize oil companies and exonerate drug dealers. What more do we need to know? I mean, doesn't that pretty much kind of cover the whole spectrum here? Hey, quick commercial break, but definitely want to stick around for this. We're going to replay our interview from 1 month ago with frontrunner for the GOP, Mr. Donald Trump. Right back after this.
Patriotic Warriors is a grassroots organization built to engage our community. While others talk about preserving our constitutional republic, Patriotic Warriors is taking action to restore the American dream. If you're truly concerned about the future of this great nation, visit patrioticwarriors.com today. The time is now. Patrioticwarriors.com. That's patrioticwarriors.com.
Hey America, I am so excited. I found eVoiceAmerica.com. It's the political take action site we've all been waiting for. eVoiceAmerica.com makes it easy to email my opinions directly to all my elected officials and representatives in Washington at once. And I and all of you can know what we are telling Congress for the first time in history. eVoiceAmerica.com. All you need to do is register with your address and zip code, log on, and eVoice America will provide your personal list of elected reps every time you log on, and much more.
Been looking for an online gathering place? You know, a familiar screen, does everything you're used to, except give you grief for being a conservative? You've got to try the Tea Party community. At TPC, you'll know how everything works from the very first minute, and you'll probably find a lot of friends who are already there. Organize, communicate, share ideas, upcoming events, pictures and videos. The Tea Party community connects and empowers like-minded, politically conservative people. Like you, sign up today at TeaPartyCommunity.com.
A-Game Consulting Services is an industry leader in the implementation of lean manufacturing techniques. If your business is suffering from declining profits during these difficult economic times, contact A-Game Consulting Services today. The staff at A-Game Consulting Services has been implementing lean manufacturing at businesses around the world for many years now. Whether you're a small business or a major corporation, lean manufacturing can have an immediate impact on your bottom line.
Here's what former Speaker of the House and presidential candidate Newt Gingrich had to say about lean manufacturing.
They should institute Lean Six Sigma across the entire federal government. A hard idea for Washington reporters to cover, but an important idea because it's the key to American manufacturing success.
Although the principles of lean have been around for several years, no business does a better job of implementing this proven methodology than A-Game Consulting Services. Their staff of master black belts will create a detailed plan specific to your organization. Imagine having a workforce that functions in complete harmony, all working towards achieving well-defined company goals. Or how about being able to find and eliminate unnecessary waste that exists in every business? Regardless of your business model, A-Game Consulting Services has a program that will work for you. So if you're looking for a surefire way to improve your bottom line, contact A-Game Consulting Services today at 904-435-8414. That's 904-435-8414. Or email them for more information at info@visitacs.com. That's info@visitacs.com. As a proud sponsor of this program, just mention the Don Smith Show and you'll receive a free no-obligation consultation. Contact us today and you'll be on your way to developing your A-game.
A doctor, running late for a medical convention, loses his computer, exposing thousands of patient records to identity theft. Data breaches can happen that easily. We don't believe you should be a victim of someone else's mistake. We're LifeLock. We constantly monitor the web, so if any of your personal information is misused, we're on it. Call 1-800-LifeLock or go to LifeLock.com today.
Hey, this is Ted Nugent. I'm on the Don Smith Radio Show, where it's okay to be a real conservative.
Welcome back. Hope you're having a great weekend so far. Hope you had a great Christmas yesterday. I want to thank everybody for tuning in today. I know it's the day after Christmas, so really appreciate you all being here. Obviously, for 2015, for the Don Smith Show here, the biggest get for us was Donald Trump, because he's the biggest interview out there. So it was great to have an opportunity to sit down and talk with him, and we will have him on again for a new interview, working that out right now here for January. So have something here in the next couple weeks for you. But just an opportunity to get to him. This is a guy who's getting like 350 media requests a day. Imagine that. So to be able to be included in that and have an opportunity to talk to him was great, especially given his position right now as the front runner of the GOP party. Looking like he might be on his way to a nomination. Long way to go, but so far nothing's hurt the guy. And I think that's the biggest issue. That's the biggest thing people look at when they look at Donald Trump. They say, man, the guy says some of these things, and you get all these pundits, you get George Wills and all these people coming on, Chris Steyerwaltz, saying, ah, that's it. That's it. The guy's done. But he's not. It's resonating with a large percentage of the American people, and not just conservatives. People are sick and tired of all the talk. Now, if he becomes president, does that change? Does he actually do something? I think a lot of people, and kind of where I'm at right now, is I think he's got the best chance of actually doing something. I love Ted Cruz, but there hasn't been a lot accomplished with Ted Cruz. A lot of great ideas, a lot of things that I support, but they don't go anywhere. So with somebody like a Donald Trump, would they, you know, we really don't know. We really don't know. But I think a lot of us think that some of the other candidates, maybe it is just talk. So to have an opportunity to sit down with Donald Trump, when you look at all of the candidates, and this is one of the opportunities that we get doing what we do here, is we've worked with all of them at one point or another. Now, Jeb Bush, you haven't heard him on the program, has absolutely the worst campaign team of all. I mean, there was a period of time. They'll reach out to the show, and they want to be on, and then you reach back, and you say, okay, yeah. And they are the most unprofessional, disorganized campaign that I've ever spoken with. And there's been a lot of them. And there's a lot of candidates, lower tier candidates in the GOP race that you don't even see on the debate stage that have some pretty amazing organizations. But I've got to say, that Donald Trump's organization is, man, I mean, very efficient. They were great to work with, very, very pleasant and very professional. I think that's the big takeaway I had with the other campaigns. Ted Cruz has a pretty good group there as well. Not in the race anymore, but he was one of my favorites as far as, especially when it came to his staff, was Governor Scott Walker, I think that was the big surprise of the 2015 year, that he didn't make it any further than he did. Because I think when he came in, he had a pretty good boost, but he had a great campaign staff as well. Some of the others, Jeb Bush, I would also put in a category. John Kasich, not very good. Huckabee's isn't very good to work with. These people, you got to like, it's almost impossible to get a dialogue going with them and to take that somewhere. So, again, the big get for us this year was, of course, Donald Trump. And I thought it was the best thing that I took away from this interview was that we went an entire 11 minutes without a single slam on another one of his candidates. So we just talked issues and talked about business, because I think this is important. We've got a president right now who's never run so much as a lemonade stand, but if you listen to him talk, he's an expert on business. He knows what's wrong with the business community. He knows why jobs aren't being created. He doesn't know any of it. Okay, he doesn't know any of it. At least with Donald Trump, here's a guy, they mock him. They mocked him for talking about taking $1 million loan out from his father. He's worth over $2 billion, folks. If you knew that the next president, you could give him $1 million and he could turn it into $2 billion, how is that not a positive? I guess that's the one thing I really don't understand about what's going on with some of the backlash against this. But again, this was the interview for us. This was the interview of the year. We'll have him back again next year. But here's my sit-down with GOP frontrunner Donald Trump. Well, it's with great pleasure that I bring you the GOP frontrunner, and yes, he still is the GOP frontrunner, Mr. Donald J. Trump. Mr. Trump, welcome to the Don Smith Show.
Well, thank you, Don.
You know, one of the things, we look at leadership, and a lot of people talk about leadership under this administration, but I think one thing that's truly important, and I think a lot of Americans would agree, is understanding how business works. How important is it to a Donald J. Trump to have the next president be somebody who actually understands how business works?
Well, I think one of the reasons that I've resonated is people understand that I know about business, and I know not only deal-making but also management. And I think it's a very important element in what we're getting into, because, frankly, if you look at what so many countries are doing to us, the way they're taking advantage of the United States, that won't happen with me. And we'll make our country rich again, and we'll make our country great again. But you need a business background, at least especially now when we're doing so badly. We owe $19 trillion in debt, and we're doing so poorly. And I think a person that has a tremendous record at business would certainly be a help.
You know, when I hear your slogan, Make America Great Again, Donald, I think about all the things that we're told we can't do anymore. You just mentioned the debt. We can't fix that. We can't stop spending. We can't build a wall. We can't deport people. All these things that we supposedly all of a sudden can't do, Americans can do these things. Am I right?
Right. Well, you certainly can, and we need a wall. And if you want to ask about walls, ask Israel. They have a wall, and it works 100% or almost 100%. And, you know, they've had tremendous success with it. And we need a wall, too, from the drug standpoint, from people coming over, just walking into our country. We can't do that. We're a country of laws, and to come into this country, you have to come in legally. And I love people coming in legally, but that's the word. They have to come in legally. So we're going to build a wall. Mexico's going to pay for the wall. You know, everyone says, the politicians all say, oh, you'll never get them to do that. Well, you will get them to do that, and the reason is we lose a tremendous amount of money every year on trade with Mexico, close to $45 billion. I mean, the numbers that are staggering. We're losing so much money, and we give Mexico tremendous amounts of money. So they'll get a little bit less, and we're going to build a wall. It's going to come from Mexico, and the wall will be built, and it'll be paid for essentially by Mexico.
You know, this is one of the things that I hear a lot of people dispute. Oh, there's no way you're going to get people, Donald, they don't understand. If you don't understand business, you don't understand a little term called leverage. And we still actually have that around the world, don't we?
Well, we have it all over the world. I mean, if you look at China, what they're doing to us, they're taking our money, they're taking our jobs, they're taking everything. We have all the leverage. We've rebuilt China. You take a look at just what I said about the wall. Everyone said to all the politicians that I'm running against, frankly, every one of them, well, you'll never get Mexico to pay. Well, then when I explained that we have a trade imbalance of $45 billion a year, and when I explained that we give billions of dollars over the years to Mexico, people start saying, oh, maybe we can get them to pay. They don't know. They don't have a clue. It's not what they do.
You know, we're talking business. So we're talking about business improving the economy. Here's one deal, and I agree with you. You've made the comment that the Iran deal is one of the worst deals you've ever seen, and I think absolutely from a national security standpoint. But let's talk about a business deal out there that has yet to hit the American people, and that's this climate change deal with China. Donald, for 16 years, they're not only going to not do anything to cap emissions, they've already said they're going to double their CO2 output. What are we going to do? We're going to cut ours by 26 to 28% in that same period of time. Cost of labor, cost of energy, these are huge
right.
things that impact business. Is this the worst deal you've ever seen?
Well, I think that there's so many of them. We make them all. I think the Iran deal has to go down as number one, but you look at the deals we make with China, where they're going to go out 32 and 35 years before they start meeting certain standards, and we have to do it immediately. And the problem with that is our businesses can't compete. Then you wonder, why is China so much more competitive? There are many reasons, most particularly the devaluation of their currency, which is just incredible what they're doing to us. So China is killing us in every way. Yesterday there was a front page article in the New York Times that China is using much, much more coal, and just spewing it into the air. Not clean coal, because there's a place for clean coal, but they're using, just spewing it into the air, unlimited amounts of coal. And it was an amazing article, and it was the main story on the front page of the New York Times, that they've totally violated everything that we've even thought about. And that's the way it is with China. That's the way it's always going to be with China. And then we wonder why we can't compete. We can't compete because of things like that.
How big is it? Because I think this is something you understand probably better than a lot of people. The cost of energy. I mean, one of the things that created the Industrial Revolution here in America, that one of the things that made us great is low cost of energy, the ability to produce and compete. How important is that when we talk about comparing the U.S. to China or India?
It's a huge factor, Don. And frankly, it's a factor that now for the first time in many, many years can turn to our advantage, because due to new technology and fracking and various other things, we have so much energy under our feet. We don't need it from the Middle East anymore. Very shortly, if we'd open up, we certainly wouldn't need it. We don't need it from anywhere. We have it for ourselves, and we have excess capacity that we can sell. And, you know, we're a huge seller of coal to China, if you think about it. So we can't use coal, but China can. And China's using it in a very unfortunate way. So whoops, you have a buzzer going off there, Don, but that's okay. Did you hear that buzzer?
I heard it in the background, yeah. I'm not sure what that is.
Yeah, something going off, but that's okay. I don't know if it's your phone or mine, but that's okay. Regardless, it just makes the conversation more interesting. Maybe that's the Chinese calling, asking us to stop talking about it.
We're being hacked,
but,
Don.
But it is a tremendous problem, and it's a problem that that we really can now make an asset. But the problem of China and what we're doing and our negotiators that don't know what they're doing is a tremendous problem.
Now, I want to shift gears a little bit, because my listeners, something they're very passionate about is, I'm a veteran myself of the submarine force. I have a lot of veterans out there listening. And you're
right.
The only one to me that I've heard even address the issues of the VA.
They don't talk about the veterans.
They don't want
I'm
to.
I'm there. I see the other candidates. They never even mention the veterans. They don't care about the veterans. They don't even mention them. And you're right. I think I should get, I mean, I hope to get 100% of the veteran vote. I'm the only one that cares about the veterans. I have
exactly.
a veteran's plan out where if the veteran has to wait, they go to a doctor and we pay the bill. A doctor that's, you know, located fairly near, or a hospital that's located near, even if it's public or private, what difference does it make? They have to get care. We're losing thousands and thousands of veterans a year. I mean, the numbers are staggering when you really hear. They're dying because they can't get care. So I'm going to take care of the veterans, and nobody else is even talking about the subject, just like nobody else really talks about illegal immigration until I brought it up.
That's exactly right. Yeah, I want to mention that was a question, actually, that came to me from a group called Citizens for Trump. You have a lot of grassroots organizations out there, and no, to my liberal friends, this is not a super PAC. They're grassroots volunteers. So I just wanted to mention Citizens for Trump.
I do have. I mean, it's amazing. I see so many people. I'll go out on a tour, and you'll see these shirts with logos with Trump something and Women for Trump and Vets for Trump, and these are organizations, and I don't even know about them. They're just forming because they want to help. They hear what I'm saying. They know me. They've known me for many years indirectly, I guess, just by watching. So I guess I've been pretty much of an open book. But I have tremendous support out there. There's no question about it. And that's why my polls, I'm leading in virtually every state. I guess I'm leading, now that I'm leading in Iowa again, I'm leading in every state.
Well, you're the Donald. Hey, I want to talk about this. You got a new book out here. Tell my listeners, tell us about Crippled America.
Well, Crippled America, tough title, and I decided to go with that title. It was a little bit like, should I do it or should I not do it? Even the picture was the worst picture I took, and I used it because it showed that I'm not happy. We have a country that is in such trouble with the debt, $19 trillion in debt, with our military can't do anything. We just, you know, don't win anymore. We have ISIS we can't beat. Now ISIS is blowing up airplanes and other things, and everything is wrong. The Iran deal, the Sergeant Bergdahl, we get him. He's a traitor. He's no good. He's a traitor. And they get five of the killers that they've wanted. Everything we do is wrong. We can't make trade deals, etc. So I talk about this in the book. Most importantly, I'm just not a critic. I talk about how to fix them. And I think the book hit number one on Yahoo yesterday. So after 2 days, it hit number one. It's the toughest book that I've written, and I think the hardest I've worked on a book since The Art of the Deal.
Well, I got to tell you, I was down at the campaign rally you did here in Jacksonville here a couple of weeks ago.
Oh, yeah, that was great.
It was amazing. And it wasn't just a speech. Donald, it was an event. You mentioned all the people with the shirts and all that. I mean, this was an amazing event.
It was amazing.
It was.
They're all amazing. I mean, I go to Dallas, it's the same thing. I go to Oklahoma. We had 20,000 people in Dallas, 20,000 people in Oklahoma, 35 people in Alabama, 35,000 people. In Alabama, when you think of it, 35,000 people, we had to use a football stadium. It's amazing, and the level is just like you saw in Jacksonville, which is such a great place, and those people were so incredible. But it's like that all over the country. It's like a movement, and they just want to stop being ripped off by everybody. They're tired of being ripped off by every country. You look at this Iran deal where we give them $150 billion, we get nothing, we don't even get our prisoners back, and they're tired of being ripped off.
And you know what I think it is? I think it's courage. I think you're the only candidate that has the courage to actually do something about it. And I think that's what's resonating with the American people. Donald, thank you so much for your time. I know you've got a busy schedule. I appreciate you taking time to be on the Don Smith Show today. And get back out there and make America great again.
I will, Don, and I appreciate it very much. And you take care of yourself.
All right, you do the same.
Thank you very much.
That's Donald Trump, everybody.
So that was a sit down with Donald Trump. Again, I think the greatest thing for me was he made the one general comment about none of the other candidates talking about veterans. But other than that, this is one of the big problems we have. I think this is what people want to hear about. How are you going to do it? What do we need to get better at? Where do we specifically cut down the unfair advantages that countries like China have and India have? Those are the things. But you see these interviews with Donald Trump, and everybody wants to know what he thinks about what so-and-so said, or they want to have the big food fight. And I think the American people, this is one of the things I think the American people are most frustrated with current state of journalism today, with so-called journalism, is it's a food fight. And that's not what people want to know. We get all these people on here. You've got all these liberals out here now telling us, okay, well, you can't vote, you shouldn't vote for this person, that person. Liberals want to tell you, conservatives, who to vote for. Dana Milbank just came out with something here recently. Oh, he's sick of Trump. Trump needs it. It's not up to you. Dana Milbank is not voting for Trump or any other GOP candidate. Period. Period. George Will came out the other day with an article. Well, you know, we got the biggest thing conservatives should worry about is getting rid of Donald Trump. Really, George? Really? Because who knows more about being a real conservative than George Will? The guy who said he knew Barack Obama was going to be a great president because he looks good in a suit and tie. Yeah, that's some real insightful stuff there. This is going to only accelerate, especially as more candidates drop out throughout. Certainly there's going to be a period here after the new year where you're going to see a lot more people dropping out of the race, a lot more people doing what Lindsey Graham did here very recently. And it's going to get worse. Because these people, the constant thing you're going to hear is that Donald Trump could never beat Hillary Clinton. Really? Does anybody remember 2008? Hillary Clinton versus Barack Obama? Because that was impossible too. These people have been wrong about everything when it comes to Donald Trump. That's it for him. Oh, he just said this. That's it. He's done. No, he's not. No, he's not. These people aren't as smart as they think they are. But it's all about a food fight, and that's not what we do here. So if there's one thing that we really, not to, you know, blow our own horn, or I won't break my arm, pat myself in the back here, but it's the one thing that we try to do here is to never do that. I talked about having Jeb Bush on the program. The honest answer to that is I don't want to have Jeb Bush on the program because I don't even know what I would talk to him about. We are so different when it comes to politics. There's very few things that Jeb Bush has ever said that I could embrace. So what am I going to talk to him about? Am I going to mock him? Am I going to – we don't do the food fight here. And that was the whole purpose with every interview we do. But especially with Donald Trump, I wanted to not let him take us down that road. Stay in control of the interview. And I do have to mention – that was his phone. I just didn't say anything, but I did love his comeback. Maybe that's China calling, asking us to stop talking about him. I thought that was a great line. That was a good one. So, but this year we're gonna continue to have great interviews. This is what we do. We try to bring on the greatest people that I really want to engage in conversation with, and I think you really want to hear certain things from them that maybe you don't hear in other places. So I want to mention again, Shemaine and Ted Nugent will be on here together. We've got them both on at the same time here in January. Also, Dinesh D'Souza will be back to tell us about his latest project, and we're working on our next Donald Trump interview. So certainly we'll be back with more with that. And I always appreciate, the most important thing is you. And here it is, a day after Christmas. I can't thank everybody enough for tuning in. But do want to mention some people that are important to what we're doing here as well and have helped us a lot over the years that we've been doing this show. Dan Butcher, obviously, Pundit Press, now with SHR Media, they've combined. Definitely appreciate everything that those guys do. Richard and Laura Barris from peoplespunditdaily.com. Tim Saletti from teapartycommunity.com and Patriotic Warriors. A lot of great people out there. And a lot of people help spread the word about this show and what we do. And we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for that. We wouldn't be doing the show if it wasn't for you. So thanks to everybody who helps us and everybody who helps share the posts and spread the message about what we're doing here on the Don Smith Show. Really appreciate that. And just been really very blessed by all of this. So thank you. I appreciate that. The thing with what's going on right now and what we're going to see in 2016, because this is important, Second Amendment, First Amendment are going to both be mercilessly attacked in 2016. We're already hearing it now. The stage has been set. Barack Obama wants to tell us how we can talk and wants to take guns away from law-abiding citizens, which is not the problem. Everything that they are proposing, there isn't a single bill that they're proposing that would have changed any of these shootings. Yet they want to grab onto the emotion of it. And they, Adam Lanza, how do you keep – the kid didn't have his own gun. It was his mom's gun. So what do? You say, okay, Adam Lanza's not – this guy should never have a gun. Fair enough. There were issues. Fair enough. He shouldn't have a gun. So what are you going to do? His mom can't have one. Brothers can't have one. His friends can't have one. Where does it stop? And this is the problem with liberalism and progressivism. It never stops. Gay marriage, legal now. Does it stop? No. Abortion, Roe v. Wade, legal now. Do they stop talking? No. You've got Planned Parenthood this week who came out and trashed on businesses and individuals that lobby the government. They're one of the biggest lobbyists out there. See, their lobbying is good. Anything against them is bad. So who do you think wins out in the free speech right on that? Who needs to be protected? From which message do you think these kids at University of Missouri, for example, what message do you think they feel the need to be protected from? The message that says, oh, we should be able to sell any body parts we want. Or the part that says, geez, you know, that's kind of disgusting. You probably shouldn't be doing that. That would make them feel unsafe. That's scary. That's scary in American society that we've gotten to that point where speech can be considered unsafe. Has anybody ever said anything to you that makes you feel unsafe? I mean, I've had some people say some pretty crazy things to me, but never anything that really made me feel unsafe. Unless it's a death threat or, okay, yeah, we probably shouldn't allow that. But really, expressing your political views hurts somebody? Causes damage to them? When Donald Trump came on the scene, remember the, okay, Donald Trump came out and the big thing was the immigration, which just captivated the American people. That's why he shot out to the lead that he did immediately, because nobody talked about it in the terms that he used. But then you had people like the nut jobs on The View who tried to say that somehow Donald Trump was responsible. This is the big thing we're going to hear in 2016 too, is the tone and the rhetoric. Because it's whenever something bad happens, it's the Republicans' tone or things they've said that create these issues. They're not. But this is what they put into the mind of the American people, and there are a lot of people that buy into it. Listen to what the View ladies had to say. This is after the Kate Steinle murder, which highlighted everything that Donald Trump had said to be true. But here's their take on it.
This guy wasn't in only...
deported five times. Yes. Everyone was paying attention.
But how did he get back in? How did he get back in?
Isn't it interesting that this happened as soon as Trump started to talk about this? He randomly found a gun from
sure
a federal agent.
Criminal no, wasn't watching no,
but
CNN.
But look at the news. They reported it. They should have been showing more of these beforehand. For instance, I just feel it's very interesting. And how do you feel about Trump talking about Hillary, about how if she's president, there's going to be just a flood of murders and a flood of things going on?
So there you go. Donald Trump is to blame for the Kate Steinle murder. Because that makes sense, doesn't it? I mean, I guess if you're a Kool-Aid gulping nut job, maybe it does. But to me and you, probably not so much. Then you had the whole Chuck Todd thing, right? Words matter. Honesty matters. You want to be president of the United States. Hillary Clinton, for crying out loud. Sir Edmund Hillary, complete lie. Benghazi, complete lie. Bosnia, complete lie. But what they're talking about with Donald Trump is that people were celebrating. Now, he said thousands on rooftops, and so maybe it wasn't thousands. But there were reports all over the place. And people like Chuck Todd can't seem to come up with them. What? There's no vindication. Here is CBS News. It's the night of the attacks. Here's CBS News.
However, what no one outside the terrorist task force knows is that just a couple of blocks away from that Jersey City apartment the FBI raided yesterday and where they had evidence removed is another apartment building. One that investigators told me, quote, is swarming with suspects. Suspects who I'm told were cheering on the roof when they saw the plane slam into the Trade Center.
There's actually a number of other stories that corroborate the same thing. Different groups of people celebrating on rooftops in New Jersey. Yet he's a liar. That's all you need to know. If you're on the left, you're good. No matter what happens, you're good. If you're on the right, no matter what happens, you're bad. That's where we're at today as a society, and that's where politics is today. So this should be a great year, 2016. And it will certainly be an interesting year. We'll see how it plays out. But let's hope. Let's hope whoever the GOP nominee is, that it's somebody with courage. Because without courage, there's no way to turn around what's taken place under hope and change. Hey, great to have you all join me the day after Christmas. Of course, Donald Trump, Gretchen Carlson, and Judge Andrew Napolitano from our recent interviews. But glad to have you all here. And again, thanks to everybody for tuning in every week. I wouldn't do this if you weren't there, obviously. But we've been very blessed here on the program. And I just want to take the time to let you know how important this is to me and how important you all are to me. And I hope you'll be back here next Saturday, day after New Year's Day. And I hope you're recovered by then. We'll have a brand new show starting at noon Eastern time next Saturday, January 2nd. Everybody, enjoy the rest of your Christmas weekend. Again, I hope you had a great one. I hope you got all the gifts you wanted. Look forward to seeing you back here next Saturday at noon Eastern time. Yeah.